number 26. That's right, my Lord, chapter 26. All right, throw the rock, my Lord. That's a little throwback. They had to be here. Isaac. What do we call Isaac? We call Isaac the ordinary son of an extraordinary father. We call Isaac an ordinary father of an extraordinary son. So his dad was an extraordinary man, Abraham. His son was an extraordinary son, Jacob. But Isaac was just an ordinary man. Now we know Isaac primarily because God says, I'm the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But 12 chapters written about Abraham, 8 chapters written about Jacob, only one chapter is written about Isaac, and that's the chapter we're in. And it is really not a chapter about war, it's not a chapter about conquest, it's not a chapter about all of those things at first glance. It's just a run-of-the-mill chapter. It's just a chapter where God is putting one foot in front of the other and pushing forward. He's just living an ordinary life, but what he shows us is that ordinary men are who God is looking for, and that it takes extraordinary virtues to live ordinary lives. It takes more than just drawing your breath and drawing your salary to be the man God wants you to be. And he teaches us some things that are counter-instinctive, counter-intuitive. He teaches us through his life what it means primarily to live in what? What's our word? Meekness. The great spiritual fruit, right? The fruit of the Spirit is meekness. This business of not retaliating even when it's in my power to do so. Not fighting even when I can fight and have a right to fight. It is yielding the right of way, the art of giving way. That's extraordinary because it is counterintuitive. We want to fight. But Isaac shows us in this chapter, among other things, he shows us that even though the enemy is pressing him, he's teaching us how to just move on down the road. He's stronger. He has more in the way of possession and position. God is obviously blessing him, and yet though he goes through this chapter just digging these wells at every turn, he's fought, and at every turn the enemy is declaring war. Either they're stopping up the wells that he dig, his dad had digged from a generation ago. He goes back and unstops those wells, even though the Philistines had stopped him up. A wanton act of war. Isaac doesn't war. He just goes back and unstops those wells so that those wells can be a blessing to people. Everywhere he went, he's digging wells and leaving these spiritual blessings, these blessings for other people. As men of God, oh, that we would be that kind of man, that wherever we leave, it's a better place. Yeah. Wherever we leave, we've left a blessing there. The aroma of a Christ-filled life, what Paul called the savor, the smell of a blessed life that will bless others will still be in the room. You know, I've noticed this about some people. Some people, you're glad, wherever they go, they bring joy. Some folk, whenever they go, they bring joy. So I want to be the kind of guy that when I leave, everybody gives it back. You know what I'm talking about? Now, watch this. If they're hell-bent to live wrong, and my godly character puts problems on them and causes them to want me to leave, that's one thing. But when I come to a family reunion, I can still be a blessing at a family reunion. I don't have to button hook everybody and shove a King James Bible up their nose. You know what I'm talking about? You don't have to corner somebody and ruin the family reunion. You can go and be a good Christian witness, and you can still smile with your Uncle Joe even though he's a little tipsy. You know what I'm talking about? Just blessed are the balance. Yeah. That's a good beatitude. Blessed are the balance, right? Learn how to live in balance, right? Everybody, hey, listen, by the way, you used to be tipsy too. Elohim. You know, I just think that wherever we go, we ought to dig some well, and we ought to leave refreshment and a blessing to people. And Isaac does this, and we see Isaac going from one place to another. But remember last week that Isaac come to this place called Rehoboth in verse number 22, and he removed from this and digged another well, and for that they strove not. Now Isaac finally gets to the place in verse number 22, Genesis 26, 22, that the enemy is not fighting for. And he called the name of the place Rehoboth, and he said, for now the Lord has made room for us, and we shall be fruitful in the land. Guys, this is a place of ease. This is a place of fruitfulness. This is a place of elbow room. This is the seeming perfection. This is the place where he's dreamed about being all his life, a place where he can raise his young ones, graze his cattle, grow his business, all of this thing. He's there and nobody's fighting. And you say, finally, Isaac, that's wonderful. And it is wonderful, but it's also dangerous. That's our point. That place where there are no more battles to fight, that place where we get where we can pack it in now, we can settle in and enjoy all the things of life, that's a dangerous place because real spiritual battles happen there. And we can become victims there. We told you about this basic principle that's taught throughout the Bible called what I call the foolishness of fullness. There is a foolishness that comes in our hearts with being full and satisfied. You know what I'm talking about? When all the bills are paid, everything is just right, not a ripple of on the water, everything is good. There is something in the fallen nature to get a little high-minded. To become proud of what we ought to be humbled by, right? Yeah. To begin to look at all of our blessings. And God warned it to his people all the time. Beware, 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 lest when thou hast eaten and are full, you forget God. When you finally got the raise and you can buy, you got more than two dimes to rub together, you know what I'm saying? Your bills are getting paid off, and now you can save a little something. Now you can take the vacation. Now you can buy different stuff. Now you got you know, life is good. Beware, right? Beware. So now we see him. He's in this place, and here's the great lesson in this is that for no apparent reason, in verse number 23, the Bible says, and he went up from there to Beersheba. And that's my point. We see Isaac making a move here that most of us wouldn't make. And that is, when you come to that sweet spot, that's the sweet spot. Why leave here? It doesn't give us one word of explanation why he leaves. The only thing I can figure out is that he understood what we must understand is that that place of seeming perfection is not the place of perfection. It is a place where we can thank God for. I'm not telling you not to thank God for the Rehoboths. Thank God for those places. But I'm telling you, beware in those places. On your journey, you get to a place where you don't have to fight it. It's not held by the acre. Thank God for those places. But I'm telling you, that's a dangerous place. And I think Isaac understands that. I think Isaac understands that, hey, listen, I can get this. You remember when we used to listen to the stations on the radio and you take that tuning knob and you run that thing down? You remember how sometimes, I know this has happened to everybody who's over 30, who had to do that, right? I don't know nothing about this, but I'm talking about, have you ever listened to a radio, maybe, where it's just a little bit off the station? And you listen to it all day because you think that's good. That's as good as it gets. And you mess around and bump the knob and it comes in clearer. Now that's, I'm right on the station now. You follow what I'm saying? But you've been listening to it just off of it. Had a little crackle in there, but you thought that's as good as it got. And you turn it just a little bit more and it comes in so clear. I believe that's the same way it can be in spiritual lives. You get to a place and we think, man, this is it. And yet it's not it. It's one click more. And in the Christian life, I'm going to tell you, most often the place of comfort is not it. It seems like it's it. It's that place of comfort, that place where there's elbow, that place where there's faith, it seems like it's it. I'm going to tell you something. That's not God uses more, and usually we're more blessed when we go just beyond our comfort. When we go to that place where, hey, listen, there might still be work to do. You follow what I'm saying? There's still, like Jabez prayed, increase my territory, enlarge my territory. There's still territory to be taken. You follow me? There's still labor. We've got to go past Rehoboth. You would wonder, why would they leave here? Why would they leave? Well, he pulls up the rigging and he takes off. And I think in our spiritual lives, maybe I'm talking to people now. And boy, it's been held by the acre all your life. And now you in the sweet spot. I want to just tell you, both in your life, this is spiritual application. Hey, go beyond it. Don't stay here. Pull up your rigging and say, God, wherever you go, that's where I want to be. And I want you to notice that in chapter number 2, verse number 23, he went up from there to Beersheba. Now watch. And notice this. Verse 24. And the Lord appeared unto him what?
The same night.
I believe that's God's endorsement. I believe this is God's endorsement to Isaac. I believe this is a heavenly attaboy. Follow me? A heavenly attaboy. You're willing to go beyond the place of ease and comfort. That sweet spot. That seemingly peaceful place. And God shows up the same night, and God affirms again now in the life of Isaac. He's done it earlier in the chapter when he told Isaac, don't go to Egypt. Stay in the land. I'm your father's God. I'll be with you like I was with your father. So Abraham and Isaac and all his digging wells in this country, and he's getting fought for. He comes to this place where it's a wide spot. God has given him place. He said, I can be fruitful here, and perhaps you can. But the fruit really is not in abundance in that place. It's in the next place. And so he goes to this next place, and God is there waiting on him. Following? I mean, he's following the Lord. You cannot walk with God and stay in the same place. And so he says, I'm going to go home with God. And as I pointed out last week, maybe his workers couldn't understand that. Maybe his family didn't understand it. Maybe Isaac didn't understand it. But the idea is the Lord is moving on. Here's something I think sometimes. I think we look at the Lord, it's kind of like a river. And sometimes we're walking with the Lord, we're in the river. And we think, well, I'll jump out of the river for a little while and do my own things, and I'll jump back in, and I'll be at the same place I was when I jumped in. And sometimes I'll get back out. Now, so some of us, sometimes maybe we have these spasms of spirituality. From time to time, you get a little spiritual fervor worked up, you're worked into a little lather, and there's a little time where there's so you're in the river. Well, just like that, something happened. You get busy with all kinds of stuff. Not going to matter this much, but it seems so important.
Yeah. Come on, man.
I'll preach it. You get all sidetracked with junk, right? And you get out of the river. And we think, man, we just get right back in where we got out, and it's not so. Now, it may look like we got back in where we got out, but let me tell you something about the river. That river ain't still there. That river's going on down the road. You in a different place.
Yeah, that's good.
Follow what I'm saying?
Amen.
It looks like the same place. But that water you got out of it. one of my people come up and always talks about C. Gamble. Well, I'm in my office there, and he comes in, and I open my door, and I pull out one of these dumb pops, a lollipop to give to him. Now, that little dude knows where the drawer is now, So now, it's more about the lollipop than it is about Gamble. When he comes into that door, it's not primarily me he's going to see, it's the drawer he wants to see. He's trying to lean for that drawer. And, we say, boy, this little rascal, but that's exactly what we get happy with the blessing. God is a blessing. God goes in this drawer and gives us a blessing, and now our eyes are on the drawer. And the drawer's full of blessing now. The drawer's full of blessing. Follow me. How much shorter? He's a granddad. I got more than lollipops. I got more than that. And God says, listen, I got more than stuff. I got the stuff that money can't buy. You walk with me. So Isaac gets a lesson to all of this. God comes and affirms himself. God shows up. I make a heavenly endorsement to Isaac as he keeps walking with God. Don't stop in that sweet spot. Don't stop. Don't stay at the place of blessing. I want to follow the blesser. Yeah. And the blesser says, here I am. I'm the God of your dad. You tell you that? I said, tell you. That's my person. He says, I am the God. I'm Yahweh. That's my covenant name. I am the one who keeps covenant. I am the one who makes a promise and keeps it. That's who Yahweh is. That's who Jehovah is. Right? Don't worry. Don't fear not. I got these boys. Fear not. You follow what I'm saying? I'm with you. And by the way, all this land, these guys stopping up well on it, all of this is yours. Give it to you, to your seed. I promised Abraham, I'm reaffirming the promise. I'm the blesser. This is more than green grass and good well. This is the blesser. So, he says, the Lord comes there. He says, I'm going to bless you and multiply thee for my servant Abraham's sake. God gave him, now watch this. Isaac shows up there in Beersheba. The Lord is already there. The Lord appears to him. He has the manifest presence of the Lord, not just his blessing. And so God reveals himself to Isaac there. It's not the first time. He's done it early in the chapter. But God reveals himself. And let me just say, guys, every revelation demands a proper response. So what does Isaac do? And he built it there and all. You follow what I'm saying? When God shows you who he is, it demands. There's a song we say about love lifted me, love lifted me. Love so mighty and so strong, I say. And so true. I love this word. Married my soul's best song. When I consider the love of God, when I survey the wondrous cross, when I think about it, when I measure it like I should in my mind, I would treasure it like I should with my heart.
That's right.
Our problem is we don't take time to measure. We don't take time to find out what the length and the breadth and the width and the depth. We don't take time to measure it. We don't take time to survey it. Gather it all in to appreciate it, like a jeweler looks at a diamond. He doesn't just glance at it; he takes it out. Takes out this, what do you call that thing? A loop. And he takes it. He examines every facet of it: the cut, and the clarity, and the color, character, carat. He examines it all, turns it every way. And he says, "Boy, that's valuable." He puts a value. He appraises it. And when we survey God and his love, and when God shows it to us, and we take out our spiritual loops, and we look at it, wow. Let me put it this way. Wow. We can think about mercy and grace and joy and all the things that we have and all the things that are ours. lavishes love upon us, it merits everything we have, everything we are. And so Isaac, he built an altar there and called upon the name of Jehovah. Jehovah showed him who he was, and he called on him. It means to call on him in dependence, call on him in acknowledgement. That's what it means to call upon the name of the Lord. Acknowledge him for who he is. Acknowledge that I am, you are everything, I am nothing. You don't need me, I need you. This is who God is. The idea is, because your world revolves around you, don't think that the world revolves around you. It revolves around him. And so I come and I understand that, and I yield myself before him, and I call upon him. That's how you get saved. Whosoever shall what? Call upon the name of the Lord shall be. And notice this. This is where he pitches his tent. This is where he dwells for the Lord is there. He pitched his tent there, and there Isaac's servant did dwell. I love this. This is, hey, there is such a thing as the permissive will of God, but there's also such a thing as the what? Perfect will of God. And he could have stayed in Rehoboth, and he could have stayed in that place of blessing where some of us have chosen to stay. He says, I'm going to walk on with God, and he gets to this place called Beersheba. And the Lord comes to show him that I am with you here. Well, now watch this. Watch. Not only does the Lord show up, notice verse number 25 says, he built an altar, he pitched his tent, and his servants what? Dig the well. Right? This is his worship life. He built an altar. This is his witness life. He what? Pitched the tent. Remember what we said the tent represents? Fact that what? We're pilgrims and we're always moving on. Why didn't he build a house, class? Because the Lord is moving on. So I might put my tent pegs in, but I don't even put them in too deep. I have to snatch them up in the morning because I'm following the blessing. And this world is not our home. It's like Abraham who's looking for a city that had foundation, right? Whose builder and maker was God, so he never built a house. Always with that tent, always a pilgrim, always moving on. This world's not my home. I'm just a passing through. You know that old hillbilly song? My treasure, my hope, somewhere beyond the blue. And this world beckons me. I don't know that song. But that has never kept me from singing a song before, not knowing the words. Oh, yeah, the angels beckon me. I know there's some hillbillies in here. The angels beckon me from God's celestial shore, and I can't feel at home in this world. this old group, I'm digressing now. This old group used to sing this song, and I remember a friend of mine, he's a Marine, gave it to me, and I was just a new believer, maybe 1 or 2 years, and it was this sort of bluegrass country music, and I don't know who in the world sang this. Somebody said it was Chuck White, I don't know what it was, but they sang this song, "We're Not Home Yet, Children. Keep your eyes upon the Savior. Just a few more days to labor. We're going to sit down beside the river. How I long to be with Jesus and my loved ones don't ever. We're not home yet. But the idea is, this is not it. And that place of arrival where the world says, this is it. You have what everybody wants. You got to understand that there is something beyond that. This world knows nothing of Beersheba, spiritually speaking. That place where you just follow the Lord, just keep on going with the Lord, and he manifests
his presence with you. And though it may not by the world standard look like the place you want to be, but it's nothing like following Jesus. Amen. Nothing like walking. So let's go on. He builds his worship life. He pitches a tent. That's his witness life. He did to well. That's his work life. Okay? Watch this. Worship, witness, work. Right? How do we put it today? Work. Amen. Pray. And worship if I get around to it. We work at our play, worship at our work, and play at our worship. We really work at playing. We had the money we got for all of our fun stuff, all the stuff. We really work at our play. And we worship our work. And then play at worship. We ain't got something better to do. So I'm gonna close in just a few more minutes. Joe's group gonna sing a song for us. I say Joe's group, our band of brothers, Glee Club. Now let me say this: it better be Glee. Alright, better call Glee Club. Alright. Yeah, we take. All right, now notice verse 26. And Abimelech went to him. Now watch. The Lord shows up, then the enemy shows up at Gerar. But now watch this. It's a little different. Abimelech shows up at Gerar, and Ahuzzath, one of his friends, and Phicho, the chief captain of his army. And Isaac said unto them, hey, why y'all come to me? Seeing you hate me and have sent me away from you. I mean, what y'all coming to me for? Now watch. And they said, we saw certainly that the Lord was with thee. Isn't that a way to live in the front of your enemies? That even your enemies will say, man, this can't differ. Isn't this a way to live in such a way where he's lived in meekness? He's lived right there among them. And God just continues to bless him, because he is walking with the blesser. And even his enemies have to say, we have seen surely that the Lord is with you. And we said, let there be now an oath between us, and even between us and thee, and let us make a covenant with thee. Now, when a man's way is pleased the Lord, Proverbs 16:7, makes even his enemies to be with peace. Isaac, by the way, Abraham had made a covenant with the king of Abimelech, with Abimelech, not the same one, but no doubt one before, maybe 110 years earlier. But you notice now, they made an oath together, and in this chapter, we see that the Philistines never lived up to what they said they were going to do. They followed him and caused him harm, him covering up the wells that Abraham had digged. All of those things. Now, they had already made a covenant, and here they are 100 years later saying, let's make a covenant. Okay? And Isaac, now notice this. We want to make sure that you do us no hurt as we have touched thee. As we have not touched thee. Listen to this guy lie. And as we have done unto thee nothing but good and have sent thee away in peace. Now, that's a lie, but now watch. This is the truth. Thou art now the blessed of the Lord. Don't do us any harm. We can't do a thing against you because God has blessed you. God has blessed you. In spite of our best efforts, God has blessed you. Don't do us any harm because we hadn't hurt you a bit. Now they was kicking stuff in his well and taking his stuff. How short their memories are. And Isaac could have said, you liar, let me tell you the 10 things you did. But notice what he says. They want peace. Verse 30. And he made them a feast. And they didn't eat. I'm telling you guys, this is meekness. This is forgiveness. This is forgiveness. You know why? Because he's walking with the Lord. Right? He knows God has already forgiven him so much. How can I walk with the Lord? How can I take steps with the Lord? how can I keep on following the Lord and I refuse to forgive? So the Bible says we to be kind, tenderhearted, forgiving one another as God for Christ's sake has what? Forgiven us. I mean, if you're going to walk with the Lord, you got to learn how to forgive. And so you know what Isaac does? These guys have done him wrong, but you know what Isaac does? He admitted it to their charge. He makes them a feast. Would you make the Philistines a feast? I mean, they've been kicking junk in your well. They've been poking you in the eye. Would you make them a feast? I'm telling you, this is an ordinary man, but this is an extraordinary faith. It shows us that God can use ordinary men like Isaac, and there's so much more to learn. We're going to get through chapter number 26 next week. All right, let's go on
You can get your tickets at the door at the marriage conference tonight. Heidi O'Brien will be there. Michael will sing songs. It'll be a
wonderful time. It'll be a cheesecake recital, a cheesecake sort of a celebration there. You know, I don't know women that love cheesecake. But bring your wife tonight, $89. You can get your ticket at the door, guys. 7:30 at Calvary, 4625 Waters Avenue. As they come, let's bow for prayer. And when they finish, Richard, you will meet. Richard, Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for the lessons that we learned. God, help us now as your men to walk, God, as Isaac walked, understanding that meekness is not weakness. God, there is a time to war, and you will tell us by your Spirit what time that is. But God, as your word says in Romans 12, I think, verse 18, as much as it depends on you, live peaceably with all men. So God, as much as it depends upon us, help us today to walk in peace, Lord. Not just with some theoretical person out here whose mind, whose face we can't see, some person in theory, but Lord, with our co-workers, with our wives, our brothers and sisters, with the aggravating folk at church, help us as much as it depends upon us to walk in peace. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.